Hey everybody, welcome to Jet City Turbines on New Year's Eve 2020. Yes, soon to be in our memory this year. Anyway, it's a special day. This is not really a rant, it's more of a soft rant, but it's an important subject. So what we're going to do is talk about a subject that is, I guess it's not that common, but it's happened to me probably twice a month, once every week or so for the past 10 years. So what's that, 200 and some times? I get an email or a message from somebody who says, yeah, I'm gonna design my own engine, and it's gonna be blah, and it's gonna be blah, and blah, and blah. So could you tell me what the thing, or the this thing, or can you tell me the dimension of, or can you tell me what that's made of, or can you tell me about performance enhancement techniques, blah, 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 blah. So here's my guidance for you. If you're gonna design your own jet engine that's gonna take over the world and make you rich, first of all, no human being has ever done that, ever, in all of history. The closest you could come to would be, what, Hans von Ohain and Frank Whittle both, but they both had lots of people working with them. They had great ideas, and they eventually made something happen. Both of those guys, and many others, did expend extreme amounts of education, training, effort, and resources to get to the feeble, baby deer little engine that they had that did run, and that's great. So now you, because you've got some ideas, are going to take over the world. And hey, I am not here to poop on your parade, to dampen your enthusiasm, to criticize your plans. I'm not here to do that. I'm just saying that you should be prepared. Okay, so we've discussed these are textbooks. These are introductory textbooks. If you're going to design a jet engine, I want you to make sure that you've read a half a dozen different ones of these, cover to cover. Okay? These are introductory textbooks. This is step one, grade one, page one, second one of your process. Now, what we're going to do is I was kindly given this book by somebody who has done a small part in exactly what you think you're going to do by yourself. He's a professional design engineer who used to work for what I like to call Her Majesty's Jet Engine Constructor. Anyway, this is a fantastic book, and we're going to read a couple of pages from this, and you're going to love it. Yes, you are. If you want to know where you can get this book, you can get it by finding one that looks like this and has the same squiggly lines up there that say things, that make people make sounds with their... what does that say? I don't know. It's just stuff. Say something. If it sounds like that, you're on the right track. Look for this guy, there's a hint. Okay, before we get started, the music you're hearing in the background is by Man or Astroman. Awesome, semi-modern, modern surf rock music. I recommend it highly. Hopefully that endorsement will get me past the copyright lawyers. Anyway, another thing. There's the engine we're building. That's a turbojet engine out of an F-86 Sabre jet, which is one of these. Right there. Now, how do we make sure everything is right? Well, we don't just go by memory. There's only 6 fuel nozzles on this engine, and they each have a primary and a secondary supply. So you can fart around and hook things up and hope it's all not gonna leak, but there's a better way. You make a list and you check it twice. There's the list. We've got 1 and 2 on there so far. Number one, the primary and the secondary fuel lines are secured and ready to run. You only check it off when it's ready, not when it's almost ready. I had this argument with a coworker years ago. You don't check it off unless it's done, 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 and done, ready to go, not almost ready to go. Okay, so those two check marks, primary, check. Secondary, check. It's ready. I don't have to check fuel nozzle number one anymore. I don't have to go and make sure it's right. It is right. Checked it off. So the only time you can add a check there is once you've done the work. Not the next day. I remember doing that one. Yeah, that one's done. Yeah. No. So number two, the secondary's hooked up. The primary's not. I know exactly where I am. 3, 4, 5, and 6, I haven't even started. They're hooked up. This is number 6, it's hooked up. I have not gone through the check to make sure it's good. Once I check that thing out and it is ready to run, I put a check there. That's how you do it. You do that with everything, and it doesn't matter if you remember, because you checked it. You checked it off. If you can trust yourself to put the check mark there when it's done, and not when you're dreaming or falling with a pen and grabbing for things, then it means it's done. Bing bang. Okay, that was a mini rant. It was. Okay, Pegasus, the heart of the harrier. Now, what I like to do with books like this, because they're so awesome, is I remove the dust jacket and I set it aside because I don't want it to get worn out or torn or ripped. Okay, you're gonna like this. Okay, for somebody that's gonna design their own engine, I want them to listen to this, and we'll all find this interesting. During the 1950s, so this is back when they were simpler, this was designed in the late 40s, early 50s. During the 1950s, the process of an engine from idea to hardware was broadly in three steps. The project office examined ideas in the raw state.
Hey, I wonder if that would work.
Whether they were wholly new, such as the Olympus in 1947, or the development of an existing engine, such as the successive developments of the Proteus, or a mix of the two, Bristol became much practiced in the arts of taking an existing design and adapting it to another purpose. This included scaling an existing design up or down. Bristol was the original manufacturer of the Rolls-Royce Olympus and a bunch of other things. They've been absorbed by Rolls-Royce long since, long time ago. This Arenda 14, the Arenda turbojet, was an upsizing of the first Canadian designed and built turbojet engine called the Arenda Chinook. It was smaller. I think it had a 2,800 pound thrust. This is 72, so it's just a bigger, burlier magnification of a Chinook. Not a Canuck, but a Chinook. Sounds the same to you people that are unfamiliar with Canadian language, eh? Okay, at the heart, the turbine engine is a heat engine. At conception, within the project group, the raw basics of the engine were sketched out. Usually this concentrated upon the gas path, namely the route that air took from intake to compression, or to combustion, sorry, combustion, and then out the back as well. The whole pathway through the engine that the air takes. I'll show you one in a bit. Okay, folks, this is the Arenda engine's PS13, which is the Arenda Iroquois that was gonna be in the Avro Aero. And let's see if we can draw the gas path. Where's my, we'll make the air green. The air goes in here. Can't even see that, can you? This is the gas path. It goes through here. Cooling air goes around there, most of it. Some of the air goes in there for combustion. It's got one of these atomizing fuel nozzles, the walking stick fuel nozzles. Flames in here. Cooling air mixes in. Goes through the turbines. Goes out the back and enters the afterburner, which is back there. So that's the gas path. It just means the pathway that the gas goes through. The pathway for the gas. Calculations were made on pressure ratios to establish the increase of air pressure to be obtained by the compressor and then the amount of work that the turbines had to do to drive the compressors. The efficiency of the turbine. All of this established what is known as the engine cycle, which determines the performance of the engine. Okay, so that was step one and a half. Okay, once the fundamentals of the project had been established, calculations made, and expressed in a general arrangement drawing, it moved on to design. And this is where JG9101 worked, in design department of Her Majesty's Jet Engine Department. Manufacturer. I'm losing my place here. Oh, here a larger team got to work on it, raising individual design schemes for specific parts of this engine to be studied. Usually when an engine was wholly new, designers used the gas path and any special requirements as a starting point, establishing the fundamental engine structure around it. The carcass of the engine, meaning the compressor and intermediate cases, the combustion chamber, structural parts, and the turbine casings were all vital in carrying internal and external loads. The internal loads included particularly the rotating parts, consisting of the compressor and turbine discs and the shaft, blades and stators, all on shafts running in bearings mounted in the casings and taking from the shafts the necessary drives to the accessory gearbox. The casings carried all of this load, including, of course, the thrust of the engine, through mounting points to the airframe and received in turn G loads as the aircraft maneuvered. All these things have to be considered, and so you're getting the idea. We're not even close to being started yet. For these reasons, when an engine went into design, a variety of other specialists came into the picture. Stress calculations, performance predictions, and many other assessments had to be undertaken. Preliminary thoughts on the layout of the lubrication system, gearbox drives, temperature and pressure sensors, air tappings, and the requirements of the fuel system had to be considered, discussed, and agreed. A lot of people think you just have a pipe and you dump in fuel, like opening a beer keg and you got yourself a jet engine. Those people are not exactly in the know about what things really are. Just saying. At all points, the weight of the engine and each one of its component parts is being assessed and kept under constant review, because it has to fly, right? If you had a 100-ton weight limit, you could make a pretty efficient engine. Easy, yeah? Okay, the output of this was sufficient information, including component drawings supported by a more detailed general arrangement drawing, with which detailed design could then be undertaken. So we're starting. Now we're starting. Yeah. These were the precise dimensions and shapes of all components were drawn. These were the precise dimensions were drawn, taking account of manufacturing methods and capabilities, complete with material specifications, fits and tolerances, and surface coatings. General design standards were imposed at this time, as was the use of standard parts such as fasteners and pipe fittings, nuts, bolts, things like that. If you want to have a custom engine with everything like it was a piece of a biological system, like an animal or a plant, then you got to design every nut and bolt and pipe and connection, and that's not done because it's so ridiculously extra complication for negligible increase in performance, I suppose. Could be done, but it's not done. It's not even done. It's done more, but it's not done totally with rocket engines on the space shuttle and things like that, the former space shuttle. Those things have as many standard parts as possible, which is maybe 2 or 3%, but it's the nuts and the bolts and things like that. Okay. The output of the detailed design was a set of drawings for issuance to the development manufacturing shops. For many years, particularly during the pioneering years of turbine engine technology, the availability of a dedicated development manufacturing organization was vital to the efficient operation of development programs. Now, 50 years later, when it is customary to use computer-aided design and make the development engines on production tooling, it may seem a luxury to have a separate shop for development. And let's go, okay. The change to making turbine engines from piston engines, the manufacture of sheet metal riveted and welded assemblies was undertaken at the Development Fabrication Department, physically separate, in the West Works on the west side of Gloucester Road, as was the model shop. They're talking about the changes from making piston engines in World War II to jets. The change to making turbine engines was not easy. Some of the staff found it difficult, and some did not last long, as the high temperature world of gas turbines, or in the high temperature world of gas turbines. So, the demands of turbine engine manufacture are quite different from those of piston engines, although in some aspects similar processes could be deployed. The machining of complex light alloy castings for compressor casings and gearboxes was not dissimilar from the methods used for large radial piston engine crankcases, which were machined. Did you know that the center casing of an R2800 started off as being cast aluminum, then they went to cast steel, and then in the end, the R2800, Pratt & Whitney's dependable masterpiece, that's the title of Kevin Cameron's book that you should read if you're interested, the crankcase of the R2800 was machined from chrome moly steel. Not even your Lamborghinis or your Ferraris or your whatevers have engine blocks machined from chrome moly steel. And they did this back in the 40s for aircraft. Pretty cool. Okay,
Disks, whether for compressors or turbines, demanded large turning facilities, which were available, and large broaching machines for the blade rotor slots, or the blade root slots, which were not. So if you want to design your own turbine engine, you're going to save yourself a great deal of time and effort and expense, huge amounts, in using a turbocharger. But then if you really designed and built a jet engine, you've modified a turbocharger to make it burn fuel, and that's really cute, but it's not a jet engine. Sorry. It's interesting, but even a turbocharger jet engine has a performance level nowhere near what it would be if it was an actual jet engine designed for that purpose. For a true small jet engine, talk to Williams. If you can, buy one of their engines, if you can. They're very cool. They're only about this big, and they're turbojet and turbofan engines. Super cool. Okay, the manufacture of the compressor and turbine blades themselves was entirely new, as were the demands of sheet metal combustion chambers and jet pipes of high temperature materials such as mnemonic, a nickel steel alloy. Fan blades had to be forged for integrity, and these were bought from specialist suppliers. Bristol was a pioneer in investment casting of turbine blades, both solid and with cooling passages, and established a foundry specifically to do so. Gears of the types used in gearboxes were familiar territory. Bearings were broadly within experience, although they soon entered new territory with the high rotational speeds and high temperature environments encountered in turbine engines, where adequate lubrication, cooling, and cooling presented various new problems, and were solved by ingenious structural solutions, which we've seen in videos that I've made. One of them is about how does the rear bearing handle all that heat in the exhaust? Well, simple. It's not in the exhaust. It's very near the exhaust, but it's separated by five layers of metal and air and oil cooling. So it's very, very well taken care of. And this is all part of the design process. And all those pieces have to be manufactured, machined, made to fit and work perfectly. That's just one little bit. That's not even 1% of your engine. Okay, the Pegasus had to have its share of them. Tolerances, build standards, balancing to requirements measured in dram inches. We need to hear from our design engineer, what is a dram, a DRAM, what's a dram inch? I know what a gram inch is, but not a dram inch. Anyway, I'm sure we'll find out. And test procedures all brought new requirements to the manufacturing process. Engine test was developed as an art and a science from the early days of the Theseus, starting with outdoor test stands and eventually involving the construction of enclosed test cells. Test measurement was to become a specialist skill in its own right. You betcha. Okay, so we got the Olympus, the Proteus, and the Theseus. And I probably left out another ECS engine. And we've got the Avon and the Spey. Those are five Rolls-Royce engines. If you're going to design a jet engine on your own, you're going to be intimately familiar with all five of those and pick another five from other manufacturers to become intimately familiar with before you even think of your first drawing. Seriously. And books like this, they're not going to show you how to design your compressor blade or whatever, but they're going to show you the history of how it was done with other engines. They're going to show you that it took hundreds of engineers and hundreds of millions of dollars. And so good luck. I mean, I kind of get a humorous chuckle from comments that say, yeah, I'm designing my own engine. Can you tell me the dimension of the... I had this question years ago. I'm designing my own jet engine. Can you tell me the dimension of the compressor? Okay. Which one? First of all, I'm not a designer. I am a technician, so I put them together. I get these things, I stick them together, I test them to make sure they work, and I ship them to the customer where they fly. It's great. Dimension. Well, you could get the dimension of the diameter of the compressor, which matters because the diameter of the cases around it need to be such that the clearance is less than, in some engines, 0.100 inch with a range, you know, 0.08 to 0.1, let's say. So how do you do that? Well, you get the rotor, you put the cases in, and you measure that distance. It doesn't matter how big the cases are. It doesn't matter how big the rotor is. What matters is that clearance. So is there a measurement for the inner diameter of the case? No.
Is there a measurement for the outer diameter of the rotor? No. There's a way to measure the clearance, which is what matters. So that's one dimension, and it's different all the way down the curved profile. Where do you want me to measure it? And I don't have a caliper that big to measure it. The length of the compressor doesn't matter. The cases and the bearings and all that, they're adjusted to fit the one you have within a range of acceptable tolerances. And when you get a compressor rotor for a turbine engine, you don't measure it, okay? If it's not damaged, if it's damaged, you repair it or throw it away. If it's not damaged, it's the part. It's not like carpentry, it's not like masonry, it's not like building truck engines. Although, if you're building a truck engine and you get a crankshaft, does anybody measure the length of the crankshaft? I don't think so. You place it in, you've got some adjustments at either end, possibly a thrust bearing of some kind. You trust that it's good. You get a new crankshaft from the factory or the parts supplier. There you go. There's your 671B or whatever crankshaft. Your 16V149 Caterpillar diesel engine crankshaft. Nobody measures how long it is. You trust the manufacturer. Same thing with jet engines. Do you want I was asked for the dimensions of a compressor blade. So that's like, and I said, same thing. And they said, oh, just tell me the dimension of one, because they're all the same size, or they're all the same shape, just scaled up and down. That may be true on some engines, but not on the J79. And it's certainly not true between all different engines. Each stage has a different shape of compressor blade, and each shape is a three-dimensional curvature. The only thing that's, the length of the blade is curved. The end of it is curved to fit inside the slant of the cases. So is it curved or it's just sloped? Okay. But the what they call the pressure face, it is curved, and the curve changes from the base to the top, and so it's the outer side, which people call the suction face. I don't like that word, but anyway, it's also a three-dimensional curve, and the thickness at all points of the blade changes, so those two curves are not the same, and they change all the way up. And on any curve, the number of dimensional measurements you can take is infinite, really. So which one do you want? And then since it's a curvature going up, there's an infinite number there, so we've got infinity squared. And that's good. That's two curvatures and a dimension. Anything you want. Anything between this and that and infinity along the line. And then each stage has a different set of limits. And each stator, which interacts with that blade, has also got infinite number of dimensions. So when you ask for the dimension of a compressor blade, I don't know. Anyway, so what we're doing is we're not laughing at these people. We're not saying they're not going to succeed. I'm just saying if you want to design a jet engine by yourself that's going to compete with what's already out there and beat it, you should be aware of the task that you are attempting to do and that no human in history has ever done it. If you're really smart and really experienced and really educated and very creative, you might find a single part or a single feature of a part that you can improve upon. That happens quite a bit, I think. Then you might be an engineer. You might be an engineer in principle, in potential, in training, in profession. I don't know. But to design a jet engine from scratch by yourself and make it, and have it perform as well as what's out there today, if that was possible, it would be done. You wouldn't have manufacturers spending literally to design a completely new airliner engine. A completely new airliner engine takes tens of billions of dollars. That's why it's not really done. The TF-39 in the 60s was designed for the C-5 Galaxy. It's a GE engine, and the development of that engine was funded by the U.S. government. From that engine, GE spent millions and developed the CF-6, which was a an airliner engine for the A300, and I believe the 747, but I'm not 100% sure. That was in the early 70s. Then they continually upgraded the CF6 until they wanted to build the GE90. The GE90? I think so. So what they did was they massively upgraded and re-engineered and improved upon and built upon the base of the CF6 and made the GE90. And the GENX, I think, came after that, or before, I'm not sure. But that was a development. And the engines on the 777, right? Those are massively upgraded, re-engineered, and improved upon CF6s, which is an upgraded, re-engined, or re-engineered, and improved upon TF-39 from the 60s. And it's 2020 right now. GE hasn't made a large turbine, a turbofan engine, a large airliner engine from scratch, I think, ever. And you could say that the GE90 and the GENX and those things are, they're so much better. They're so much more massive and efficient and quiet, and they're incredible. But they are updated designs built upon way back when. The Trents, the Rolls-Royce Trents, they are massively re-engineered, upgraded, redesigned, and improved RB211s. Now, the RB211 was a turbofan engine that was all from scratch, building upon the ideas of the Spey, I suppose. But it was pretty much from scratch, and it actually did bankrupt the company. Rolls-Royce went bankrupt, spent a few years being owned by the government, charged ahead financially, and bought themselves back, and it's all great, and that's fantastic. But the expense of building a large jet engine from scratch is so great that the companies nowadays, they work together. No company does it all on their own. So anyway, just to inject some reality, I didn't mean this to be a downer, it's not depressing, just saying that if you want to ask me about particular dimensions, I'm happy to help, but if you're designing an engine, read six of these, six of them, right? And maybe a dozen of these, you'll be halfway on your way, because what you need to do then, these are elementary textbooks. These are the easy ones with lots of pictures and words. There's lots of books that have math, lots of math. One of them is Jack Mattingly's Elements of Gas Turbine Propulsion, which if you're going to design a jet engine, you should read it and you should understand it, and other books like it. Then you'll be on step one of the staircase to building your own engine. So all of the people that have contacted me about designing their own jet engine have been blissfully unaware of the challenge that's ahead. So I wish you luck, but the more you learn, the more you may realize it's a bit over your head. Actually, I got a good quote for that. Okay, at the end of this chapter, I won't read the whole thing just because, well, you know, we're going to have more of these little fireside chats, engine side chats. Well, there's a fire inside there. Not right now, but when it's running. In Flight International, a quote was found which allegedly or incorporated into the Douglas design philosophy for the DC-8. This is back in the 50s. Okay, the quote is, "We have not succeeded in answering all of your problems. Indeed, we feel that we have not completely answered any of them. The answers we have found only serve to raise a whole new set of questions. In some ways, we feel we are as confused as ever, but we believe that we are confused on a higher plane about more important things." And that's a quote from aircraft engine design engineers. Interestingly, it's very similar to my favorite quote of all time by a certain individual named Albert Einstein. And he said, "As the circle of light increases, so does the circumference of darkness around it." And that's very true. So even the smartest people in the world, they realize that the more they know, the more they realize they don't know. And the advancing frontier of knowledge is accelerating into an ever-widening universe of mystery and imagination. What do we have here? We have a ceramic-coated Arenda 14 turbine blade, See that? It's beautiful. We have a titanium stator for the fan, for the core booster of a CF6. A little dusty. Sorry about that. We have one of the first stage compressor blades from a LM2500, or the second stage of compression for the CF6. I think this would be behind or in front of this. I think so. This is a stator dealing with the fan air going into the first stage. Not sure. This is a later stage compressor blade for an LM2500 or a CF6. See the multiple curvatures and shapes and wonderfulness. This is actually a turbine blade out of a Rolls-Royce Avon. All polished up nice. And so the dimension, yes, the dimension of the compressor. The dimension is exactly, Oh, that one changes all the way up and down. Oh, there's this one. How about that one? Okay, says so right here. Says right here, the dimension of the compressor is 42. Anyway, on that note, Happy New Year, and I'm getting out of here to ride my bike in the snow with my dog. Thanks for watching.